Love smarter, not harder. Today's question. Hi, Karen. I'm a 29-year-old listener from the UK. And firstly, just want to say that I love everything you have to say about dating and relationships. Thank you so much. I'm so glad that what I'm sharing is helpful. Your advice really helped when I was going through a breakup last year. I started dipping my toe back in the dating world, and I have a question for you about how to have a balance between not settling and being too picky. To give you an example, I met a great guy for a date a few weeks ago. He ticked a lot of my boxes, like having interesting hobbies, seeming like a kind and genuine person. He was intelligent and had a good social life, etc. But I just didn't feel that spark with him. There was a lack of flirtation and playfulness in our interaction. I just felt kind of meh afterwards. So the first thing is the whole bit about being too picky. You know, I love this subject. I devoted an entire chapter in my book, Single is the New Black, Don't Wear White Till It's Right, about being too picky, because we can get in our own heads about thinking that we're being too picky, and we're certainly gonna hear it from other people. And it could be your parents, and it could be their friends, or it could be your friends. Everyone has an opinion about why someone is single if they've remained single for a period of time in their adult life. And many people's theories have to do with you being too picky. And what happens is sometimes we internalize that because we doubt ourselves. We go, well, am I hoping for something that doesn't exist? Am I believing in some Disney princess fantasy that this connection is gonna be so amazing and I should just give it up already and be more realistic? But getting back to your example, if you feel meh, that's your answer. You can't move forward with a relationship if after the first date you feel completely meh. Now, I'm not saying that you shouldn't give a second date, okay? Because I actually believe that, and I've done posts about this too, sometimes there's not that initial chemistry or sparks because one person is really nervous and so they're not able to present themselves in a relaxed and casual and fun manner. So I always say give at least 2, maybe 3 or 4 dates. But if that meh feeling continues, then there, you know, there's just no point because, I mean, what are we looking for? Are we looking for a meh, mediocre connection, a meh, mediocre relationship, or a meh, mediocre marriage? No way. Especially in this day and age when single women, we don't have to settle. It's not like 150 years ago when we couldn't financially support ourselves. We couldn't go it alone, right? We can. And I, for one, encourage all of us to go shoot for the stars, wait for the right person so that marriage is extraordinary and the farthest thing from meh, and also easier, right? Because if we get with someone who we've got those commonalities, we've got that common ground, we crack each other up, we flirt with each other, it just makes marriage so much more fun and easy. That's my first thought. So she says, I do tend to compare guys with my ex. As when we had our first date, there was an instant attraction and I knew I wanted to see him again and follow up. I want to have that with someone again and I think I deserve it. And I don't want to waste someone's time and my own time if I'm not feeling it. Now, that initial spark can be very compelling and it's very exciting to feel that. And I want to refer you to my episode with Ken Page, because Ken Page, LCSW, the author of Deeper Dating, because yes, that initial spark and chemistry is so exciting, but make sure that it's a genuine, healthy spark. Because Ken talks about how sometimes that initial attraction is oftentimes toward people who are unhealthy for us. And the reason we're so excited by them and we're so, the spark is so intense is because it's an attraction of deprivation is what he calls it. It's an attraction that we are trying to seek some healing in a part of our life through this person, but it's in the wrong direction. In psych, we talk about the recapitulation of family of origin issues. So a very Psych 101 example would be, if I had daddy issues and if my dad wasn't around, I may be very attracted to men who are emotionally unavailable, right? Because what I'm trying to do in adulthood is correct the lack of fatherly love that I was missing in my childhood. So we have to be careful. We want that strong chemistry, that initial spark, absolutely. But if it's too intense, sometimes it may be that we are initially drawn to someone hoping to repair some of our emotional wounds. So if you want more information on that, I highly recommend Ken's book, Deeper Dating, and listen to him on my podcast episode. I can't remember, it was last season. I can't remember the exact number, but it's called Deeper Dating, and it's fantastic, and I'm recommending to everyone because it's got so much depth, helping us date in a healthy and solid manner to find someone extraordinary and someone who is not harkening back to our emotional wounds. So you want that spark that you had with your ex, but obviously things with your ex didn't play out. So we want a spark in a healthy manner. Okay. So also she says, I think this recent guy that I saw felt the same about the lack of spark, as neither one of us has followed up afterwards. And she says, I've listened to your podcasts about making fear-based decisions and how we can settle for less than what we deserve when we're in this mindset of fear. And I'm conscious I don't want to do that anymore. But then I sometimes struggle with wondering if I've given someone enough of a chance or if I'm being too picky. So again, that episode is episode 4, way back, and it's called No Fear, How to Make Decisions from a Smart, Not Scared Mindset. And that was all about me almost making a major life decision from a fear-based mindset when I almost married the wrong guy, when I was engaged for a year and a half, and almost 2 months before my wedding, I called it off because I realized that I was in a place of fear and making a decision from fear, figuring I'm gonna be alone for forever. And I was only 34, but I already felt that. And so it doesn't matter what age you are, because your scary age may be 24. I mean, it could be 22, depending on your culture and what everyone around you is doing. And so when we get into that scary age mindset of, wait, I'm supposed to be here and I'm not, and everyone says I'm too picky and that's why I'm still single, all these messages can start doing a number on our mindset. And you guys know I'm all about taking charge of our thoughts, taking charge of our life. And we have to be clear about our mindset, because if we are not protecting it, those messages will infiltrate us. And that's what happened to me. I started believing the hype, believing the lies that, well, you're 34. What's wrong with you? Why aren't you married? Everyone else is married. They're starting babies and families and they're on their third kid. And I started going, wait, I must be too picky. I must be holding out for something that doesn't exist. And then 2 months before, I had that epiphany of, you know what? If I'm too picky, so be it. But I'm not going to have a meh, mediocre marriage with someone who doesn't excite me in that way, who I'm not passionately in love with. And it was trickier because he was a really good guy. He had the right job, he drove the right car, he owned the right property, he on paper was a perfect fit for me, but it wasn't that soul connection. So we have to be so careful, and it's very hard to sort out what's going on in our head. If this is truly us thinking this, or if this is just we've bought into the lies. So we have to be so careful. And that's why I'm so glad you asked this question, so I can address it, and one that we can just talk out and try to sort out what's really going on in our mindset. So how can I know if I'm giving someone enough of a chance? Is it worth going on more dates if I don't feel any attraction at all after the first one? Any tips or advice would be so much appreciated. So again, as I said earlier, I always recommend 2, 3, 4 dates even. Give someone the chance to really show themselves as they get a little more comfortable and they're less nervous. But after that, no, because what can happen is you can start doing what I did, which is going, well, he's a good guy and he's perfect on paper and I must be wanting something that doesn't exist. And then you keep going along and going along and going along. And pretty soon, like me, I was 3 years into this relationship, and then he proposes and I'm like, well, I'm 3 years in, and I mean, I guess this is as good as it gets. I don't want that for you, and I'm thankful that I was able to pull myself away, because it's not fair to him either. It wouldn't have been loving to marry a guy who thought that I was madly in love with him when I wasn't. That's not loving either, right? So it's not even about worrying about yourself, it's worrying about the other person and the arrangement that you're about to strike up. Like, okay, we're just kind of into each other, but not all that much. And then wonder why people end up having affairs with their high school sweetheart they reconnected with on Facebook. So to answer your question, your gut will tell you. That meh feeling, do not disregard it. Give it another couple dates, but Don't push something. Don't force it. So many people are out there trying to force a relationship to work just because they want a relationship so badly. So trust your gut on that. Look at the stuff from Ken Page. Listen to that podcast. Read that book so that you make sure that the attraction that you want is a healthy, strong initial chemistry and not an attraction of deprivation. I hope that helps. Again, my book, I have an entire chapter about whether or not you're too picky. So that's another option to delve into as well. Thanks. I hope that's helpful.